perhaps maybe in the digital world, things are a lot more progressive, fail fast, fail early, right? Which is not necessarily the sense or the case sometimes in the healthcare. So how do we balance, right? So we can get, I'm not suggesting that we should not, you know, necessarily take care, but how do we balance where we can foster and empower innovation to happen in healthcare, yet at the same time we can do it safe, efficient sort of manner? So anybody want to comment on that?
I spoke about that in my talk, actually. Absolutely right. The way the world's going, we need to innovate at pace, validate and translate almost in almost together. The old randomized controlled trial, which has been the kind of gold standard for decades, takes too long. You get an intervention, it takes 7 to 8 years for intervention to be clinically relevant. And then the world has moved 300 years in the next 7 years. So what we, as clinicians, as researchers, academics, say, okay, what does that new world look like? N equals one. How many put intervention in quickly? Mitigate risk. These sense we'll have a conversation. There might be more risk, but how do you mitigate it and make it safer? How do you approach it sensibly? So approach innovation at pace and implement a change. And that's a conversation you need to have. People are not having at the moment. I'm glad you asked the question. Because up to us, the community and academic researcher say, what does that look like for the new world? Absolutely.
So from a UK perspective, there's two things that we are doing. Earlier in the year, one of our regulators published some guidance, quite unique guidance, which is focused on digital health interventions and how to evaluate their clinical effectiveness and economic health economic evaluation. And it really recognised this difference between traditional, you know, real-world RCT-led innovation versus the need to focus a little bit more on real-world validation. So we're actually encouraging a lot of our innovators to spend a lot of time on real-world validation, recognising that there is a huge cost and a huge investment that needs to go into evidence generation. But actually, if you can start getting things out there into clinical practice, testing them out, getting the feedback, iterating in a safe way, then that will also help to progress this a lot faster.
Recently, I was visiting the University of Bahrain, and specifically, they have a joint program between the College of Science and the College of Information Technology. And the idea of the meeting was how we can provide them with data and you know, start some kind of research specifically in artificial intelligence and predictive analysis and related kind of topics. The main challenge is not the data. Now we are collecting the data. We have the data available, but I think what we discussed about having that framework, the legal and ethical framework, is always going to be an obstacle for us to actually proceed with this kind of activities. And I think this is where now we are at. We are trying to provide something that we can use in order to start this kind of collaboration between us as the Council of Health and University of Bahrain, who are doing a lot of research in this area.
Thank you. So I think we're gonna close this session, but I think because we have such an innovative panel, so if each of you wants to say two words of innovation and healthcare, they can be verbs, they can be, I just thought of this, but two words. Let's end the session with two words.
Activate the patients.
Activate the patients.
Activate the workforce.
Okay, yeah.
I like it. I've never done two words in my life. But I think healthcare equity.
Exponential thinking.
Thank you all. I appreciate it. We're going to honor the speakers that haven't been honored. So we appreciate it. Thank you all.
So I would like to ask Dr. Mohamed Khashoggi, the Undersecretary, to honor our guests. Please, Mohamed.